have the knowledge, so why not move forward and make it into innovation? But to make it move forward to innovation, collaboration is needed. So fun field, lot to do. We have a great group. Our mission during these 3 years has been to establish center of excellence when it comes to physical activity and health, and also with a promotion of digitalization. And we also want to develop the field of physical activity and health. We also want to lead the innovation within this field. And what is physical activity? It can be basically anything which you will hear today. It can be like Linda was talking about within healthcare. How do we treat elderly or sick patients and getting them forward, moving? And it can be elite performance within competition and sports. But we can also look at it from a micro perspective to a macro perspective. And some of that you will also see today. So the field is very vast, and it's possible for innovation within all of these fields, subfields. Within Nordink, we've had three focus areas that we tried to work within and also tried to combine. And the first is research and cooperation. We are used to doing research with researchers and being world renowned within a very narrow field. It's probably maybe 10 that reads our publications, but those 10, they know what they have been reading. But how do we get it out to the public? How do we actually commercialize that knowledge and get it into new innovation, new products that actually will come to benefit the public? So then we come to the innovation. How do we take new ideas to actually get into the market and being used? That is innovation, utilization, and commercialization. And then, of course, we have skills development. It's a constant field that is evolving, and we need new competences in all of these fields, but not at least, as we have noticed, we need to combine these fields together. And we've had the privilege to working together, as you saw in the previous slides, with Region Västerbotten, Umeå University, RISE Interactive, Korten Olympic Training Center, and Folkhälsan Finland, and try to do some new magic. And today, I would like to welcome you to our conference that will mark the end of our project period that is coming to an end by this end of this year. And as I was saying before, we are going to see some of the results that we have been working with. Not everything. Some of the results cannot be measured or put into on a paper, and that's all the new faces we've met, all the new collaboration possibilities and the knowledge and the inspiration. But we will take a dip into the sea and see, possibly give you some inspiration. So we'll start out with if digital tools can activate our young. But then we'll switch to looking at non-digital gamification. So taking a digital term and using it for non-digital purposes. We'll see if you actually can compete in innovation. And this might be a spoiler alert, but you actually can, because we have a winner. We'll looking at measuring activity. We'll look at the company. We'll have lunch. And we'll look at the role of digitalization within human performance. We'll look at VR, virtual reality, does it add? Does it make it more fun? Does it give it a cutting edge? Then we'll switch back and look at senior training and digitalization. We'll look at different health technologies that Åbo Academy University works with here. We'll see how you work with innovative technology solutions and how you develop it. We'll look at robotics. A movement across borders will be interesting as end of a panel discussion and see what we can see, which borders we can cross, if it's gender or if it's national or if it's fields or what. So this is something for today. I want to introduce you to our coach today, Camilla from Folkhälsan Finland. She will be our coach, trying to keep some order. She will let you know when it's 2 minutes and 1 minute left of your talks. And I want to introduce you to Thomas, also from Folkhälsan Finland. He will be our tech guru today. So if you're a bit worried, meet up with him in the breaks. So without further ado, let's welcome our first presenter. And that is Felix Niels Blink. Could digital tools activate our young? So we'll start out with the young today.
So, good morning, everyone. I'm going to set up my computer. So, here we go, finally. Yes, great introduction, Anna, thank you. It was a really inspiring movie you had. It makes us feel like movie stars, I think. So I'll start by introducing myself a bit. My name is Fredrik Nyblink. I work for RISE, which is the Research Institute of Sweden. And RISE is a pretty big research institute. We are 3,500 employees throughout Sweden. And I work within a branch that is called RISE Interactive. And we basically do research within design, this interactive design research. This specific branch of RISE is from the new year going to be related to RISE social transformations. And social transformations is pretty much what we're talking about when we're dealing with this issue about the young generation and physical activity. I work as a product leader, research engineer, researcher, and my background is in engineering. That's quite important to this project, both software and hardware, actually. For many physical activity. So I'm really happy to have been part of this Nordic project. So physical activity and technology. I guess how you can see the technology is a mindset. I mean, if it could be a help for physical activity or not, it's how you perceive it. A number of years ago, 8-9 years ago, I came in contact with Dr. Helena Tobiasen from KTH, and this was at the time when we mostly did projects within the process industry. And she introduced me to this field of physical activity and technology. And she was always concerned about the new generation, the young generation, how to use the mobile phones, and that you saw the young go leaning like this, and they were actually less physical active. With her interest in HCI, human-computer interaction, we started doing projects together within this field of physical activity and technology. And among other things, we started working on prototypes for walking meetings, for example. Like, how could you introduce technology into a field that is pretty boring? Like, when you have a meeting, how can you actually use technology for this? So this was what brought me into this field. So the obvious problem is that, like Anna mentioned, we all know that there's a big problem in society today. Kids are moving less. We have alarm reports from what I've been reading, Swedish Forecast Institute, where you actually see the numbers of kids, how they're moving less, and the ones that are moving are doing so in organized sports, like club activities. And also now this is dropping, so activity is dropping all over the field. And also there are social factors involved, not say the least economical social factors and things like that. So, and of course there are already great initiatives in society today that are dealing with these issues, that are seeing the problems and trying to make things happen. And we're really happy for this. So in our program area that we're talking about, the Botnia region, there are two examples that I have. One is in the Finnish Skolan I Rörelse, which is a great initiative from the Finnish government. I will not go into details, but this is an initiative where they go out actively into the schools and help them with the ideas and ways of making school kids move. So this is a really great initiative. And it seems like Finland has come further than Sweden in this case. And also in the Swedish side, there's a local initiative that is called Change the Game, which is a project that is dealing with something that's called physical literacy. Physical literacy is a way to physical movement that is considering many aspects of physical activity, like the social factors and how you make things fun and how you practice movement for the rest of your life. Our question now in this project was, how do we approach this problem with tech? Or could we use tech to actually help this problem or help these initiatives? So we see it as a challenge to meet the digital generation in their own play field, basically. I mean, the new generation, coming generation, has different presets than we have, like how you use technology and how you're raised with technology and how technology is supposed to work. So we have to find ways of using that to also support increased physical activity. And my personal approach is to use a design research way of doing this. With that, I mean trying to make probes to go out to society, and by analyzing them, by prototyping, being able to see results and iterate on them. I will show you more about this. So during 2018, Nordic started one case that we called DigiPEP. And this case was designed specifically for dealing with this problem. And the outspoken goal was to work together with partners and organizations in the region to increase physical literacy and movement. And the ways of working were network and prototyping workshop and market service. So we had some good cooperation partner with the project that I mentioned, the Change the Game project. So we had a great opportunity of working together with them. So Change the Game actually has this day, once a year they gather sports organizations and organizations that use physical activities for kids as a means for basically sports organization. Then we had a chance to represent with our technical solutions. So I'll show you. So we basically had a great opportunity to display a digital exhibition at this exhibition with non-digital events. So that was what we tried there was a few probes or prototypes just to get an idea of how to stimulate kids and see what really activates them. And the goal also is to look at motivational factors and like how you could use technology. So what we did there was try a few different things like VR and AR solutions. Like how could you use different apps in VR and AR to actually make kids move? And also some more physical prototypes, balance boards connected to games, like to use the physical world and to connect the physical world and the digital world in a way that you more or less fool them into different types of movements. Another thing we tried was a project that was called phone, I don't know if it has a name, but it was cycle to charge your phone. And you see this kid here, what he's doing, he's cycling, and to the left is his mom, and she's charging her phone. So he has to keep a certain speed at the bike for her phone to charge. And simple interventions like this actually turned out to be really, really interesting to both parents and kids. We showed that motivation increased pretty much just by adding the extra layer of this interaction with charging a phone for riding a bike. And also many parents were wondering, where can you buy this? Even though it's such a simple thing, I mean, you can just charge your phone by plugging it into the wall. So they wanted to buy this and connect it to the kids' computers. Like, how can I make my kid ride the bike to earn time for playing his computer? Another thing we did, this was one of the probes we put out. Another thing we've done within the project is a workshop called Digital Handcraft, where we actually tried to explore younger kids' perception of space. And this was a pretty early project in the beginning of Netherbank, so it's actually before the digital PEP concept came into the world. But the thing we wanted to do was to work with notions of dimensions and movement and how you make kids jump between digital and the physical. I'll show you a short video of that as well. I will not play the entire one. So what we wanted to do here was to show how you could create things in the real world. Like we were creating, let the kids create things in clay. We 3D scanned them, and we also had them look at the model in the computer, and we told them that you can take the physical world, put it into the computer, and then print it again. So we can actually shift between the real world and the digital world and back to the real world again. So that's the notion. And also when you use virtual reality to paint, you paint different forms in the digital world, which you then can save and print into physical shapes again. And also the notion of your body, how you take up space in the room. What is the difference between two dimensions and three dimensions? The next workshop we did within this concept was the technical tools. And here we tried to concentrate on how we design technical tools for children that encourages increased movement. So this was a more playful workshop, but it still had a lot of great insights. How you actually, if you start think of it, how you can stimulate, or how you can use your technical knowledge to actually create things, and create new things, and create inspiring things. So we used a group of kids as inspiration to the adults that were following the kids, and we ended up the workshop by actually creating new objects, playful objects that were using real technology. So that was really interesting. And this was one of the workshop, one of the parts where we used the kids. You see what they're doing here, we're using a camera with a long shutter time, so we can actually paint with light. It's an old trick, but you can use your body, you use technology, and you create objects, by digital objects, by using the body. So, and here was the conclusion of the workshop. This is just workshop picture. I will not show you, but this is a presentation of the concept they came up with. So the next part was actually starting to talk to the schools and the teachers and recreation instructors on how technical tools and technology is used with kids every day in the school. It turned out from that workshop that actually children 8 to 12 years, we saw the possibilities of break time activities would be something that probably could be really enhanced by technology. Like how can we use technology in breaks, like in the schoolyard and so on. So we started thinking about these types of interventions to put them out to the school doors, and also the corridors of the school. How could you use technology to modify the corridors to make kids move more during every day? So technology tools for schools. I mean, the schools, as you know, is being digitalized today, and I mean, the digitalization is over the entire school. So, and this should also include the physical literacy. And in the school, if we talk about technology for physical literacy, the school is the obvious place to start, of course. The obvious venue for interventions, and where we have chance to measure and make a real difference. So, we started by making a survey among physical educational teachers. It turned out that to map out what technology they're using today. And it turns out that teachers within physical activity today, now we're talking children 8 to 12 years, they are using a lot of technology today. They are using apps, they're using games, they're using websites, and they're using different types of pulse watches and so on. But everything they're using is dependent on their own experience, their own skill, their own drive for using technology. They have no support whatsoever. And that's also one thing that came out of this survey, that they really have ideas, they like to do stuff, but they don't have the means, they don't have the money, they don't have any support anywhere to actually do anything. So it all comes back to the person, if they actually use technology or not. I'll move to next. So, even though if we would implement technology in the schools, if they would have this support that we're talking about, we go back to a number of challenges that needs to be dealt with in this case. And now we can go back to the e-health field to look at the solutions for this. We know that when we introduce new e-health solutions, we cannot just put it out to our patients and say that, hey, we have a great new solution, use it, feel free to use it. And it will be exactly the same thing with technology in schools. We cannot just give them technology and say, hey, this will work on its own. We see that there are the issues of development. I mean, there are products out there that teachers are using today, but these aren't developed specifically for schools or specifically for kids. Teachers are actually using products that are developed for other purposes. So what we would need to do is work on development of these products or these products to support the specific need in the classroom or in the gym class. And if we have those products out in the schools, we'd need to give support during the lifetime of the product also. I mean, if you have a product and same thing in the e-health field, you need to have a supporting organization behind it also. If something happens, you need to be able to, a teacher has to be able to go somewhere and get help. You need to follow up during the entire test period. You need to have a good way of shutting down the project, taking care of the technology, and maybe most importantly, you need to follow up the results to be able to improve what you already tested out there. So it's not as simple as just taking a piece of technology and putting it out there. You have to have a thought with what you're doing, and if you do that, it could be really, really, really powerful. Also, schools or teachers, they are expressing the concerns of, if there is technology out there, but how do I know what I should aim for? How do I go about, I mean, we cannot afford doing research into different things, so there need to be an organization behind the implementation of technology, taking care of all these issues. So, the conclusion, the question was, could digital tools activate so young? And the question is definitely yes, but that there are a few things that needs to happen in order for that to happen. There are great examples like Change the Games and Skolan I Rörelse, but technology is an important component, and we could definitely support those initiatives by introducing technology. And in technology used in the right way, it can be inclusive, explaining, intriguing, and motivating, and actually make kids that are not moving move more or be active in a way that they're not today. So tech needs to be developed, it needs to be tested and packages for the schools to use, but also there are also great examples of technology not being packaged in a great way, like the, you know, all of the Pokemon Go, which is an example of technology that is used in a way that it was not supposed to be used for physical activity. But the conclusion to the question, could digital tools activate the young, is yes. So, I thank you. So, is there a question?
Does anyone have any questions for Frederik while we're inviting next speaker up? So next talk is about, this time about non-digital gamification for physical activity, and Joko Kangasniemi from Kuortan Olympic Training Center and representing Nordink as well.
Yes, thank you. On the next presentation, we are using a digital tool to show you something about non-digital things. Our main goal in Kuortane has been innovations, and we have discussion with about 80 to 100 companies or startups, and today we know quite a good what are the needs in physical activity. This is a little bit irritating. It's coming. A surprise. What our companies or startups needs is money. And other thing, next thing is but have a quick pilot testing. My colleague from Kuortan, Mikko Leppä, is telling something about non-digital developing. Let him speak.
Hello, my name is Mikko Leppä, and I work as an innovator in a Nordink project, and I will tell you more about non-digital games for physical activity now. About gamification in general, then we're going to take a look at how I design games and games for all or all abilities. We will talk more specifically about inclusion spectrum and step model, and then we're going to take a look into the future of physical activity. So hop on.
Okay, so let's talk more about how to design a game for all. So a game for all means a game that fits most needs. I will introduce you two models that I frequently use when I start designing a game or start gamification project. The model number one is like the main framework, like the big picture that I first look at. It's called the inclusion spectrum, and Inclusion Spectrum is an activity-centered approach to the inclusion of young people of all abilities in physical activity. And inclusion can be achieved by changing the way in which the activity is presented. The Inclusion Spectrum provides physical activity teachers, sport teachers, coaches, and volunteers with different methods of supporting inclusion. By delivering activities differently, we can balance different needs within the group and so helping to maximize the potential of all young people. So here you can see the Inclusion Spectrum figure. It's like a cake with different pieces of cake. And I must say that using it is quite a piece of cake. If we look at the sectors, there are modified activity, parallel activity, disability sport, separate activity, and open activity. These are like different viewpoints from where we can plan physical activity that fits all needs. I will explain what the sectors mean now. Open activity, as the name says, is an activity that's based on what the entire group, all the people in the group, can do with little or no modifications at all. Modified activity means that everyone does the same activity with modifications to challenge and support all abilities. So the activity is differentiated to fit all needs. For example, if everyone is not able to play basketball, we can choose wheelchair basketball because it's modified to a level where everyone can participate. Parallel activity means that the participants are in different groups according to their ability. They do the same activity in all groups, but at appropriate levels. Separate activity means that the participants are doing not the same thing, all of them. There might be different tasks planned, and it's okay. It's okay because not everyone has to do the same thing all the time. Disability sport, the last sector, are the activities that are designed for people with disabilities. For example, goalball is sport designed for people who can't see. So this figure by Ken Black and others can be used to make physical activity inclusive. What I like to focus on when planning activities are the sectors modified activity and especially open activity, because I want to make a situation where everyone can participate, but we are still physically active together. Let me show you examples of modified and open activities. A few years ago, I was planning new inclusive ways of physical activity at Kuortaneen Sports Institute, and I designed a concept of board games on the move, where the ideas of the board games that everyone knows are translated into physical activity. So we have a bit bigger boards than people are used to. I will now show you a video of board games on the move. There are different games introduced, and you can search if you can find open activities, the activity that fits all needs, or modified activities, for example, if we have equipment that help people play. Thank you. So I hope you found some open activities while watching the previous video, and also some modified activities, for example, in Hungry Hippos, where everyone has a sort of wheel board. But yeah, let's then move from the big picture to a really concrete tool. It's called Step Model. Step Model is a stairway-shaped model that helps us to look at ways of adapting and modifying activities to fit a large scale of needs in a physical activity. We are all quite different when it comes to physical activity, so this model is for all, basically, not just for people with disabilities. Well, the variables of this step model are space, task, equipment, and players. And we figure out how to change those variables and what it affects on physical activity. So we think, how can these aspects be transferred into game designing? And if we want to have a game, if we want to design a game that fits for all, it is really clever to do it by using this step model. I will show you what those variables really are. Let's begin from the top. The first letter is S and the word is space. In this section, we can ask a question, how does the surroundings look like? Are there proper contrasts? Is it safe to move? Is the space organized and clean? And is there a balance between stimulus and simplification? So we don't have too many things, but we have something to inspire. Some of us can handle more information than others. Do we have guidelines in easy-to-read language or with pictures? And the most interesting aspect when it comes to game designing, what kind of pedagogical structures we have? In my opinion, one of the most critical and helpful things in game designing is multi-channel communication. It means that the game offers something for your eyes and ears, something to feel, like you're in a game yourself, something to follow, clear structures, so you know what to do and what to do next and what the others are doing, so it leads to the sense of autonomy. You will get more out of a game and you will be more engaged to playing a game. The second step is called task. And this is a really a critical phase, because it's really important to design tasks that suit the game goals. For me as a game designer, it's the most important thing to design tasks that are open for all. So if the players have, for example, challenges in seeing or hearing or being physically active or understanding or concentrating, it is really important to take these challenges into consideration. And after all, these are quite common challenges nowadays. Okay, the third step is called equipment. And this section is all about what concrete things we can change to make playing different. We can have a lot of different equipment, but for example, if we have a ball, we can change the type of the ball. It can be round, can be long, it can be soft or hard or easy to catch or slippery, light or heavy, or fast or slow. Size can be big or small, and this ball can have different colors or even a jingle bell inside the ball that makes sound while the ball is moving. So we have tens and tens of options to choose from to make the game interesting and playable for all. The fourth step is the players. According to recent studies, even 1/5 of the Finnish kids have some special needs, difficulties in understanding, hearing or seeing or concentrating. So it means that there are several pupils in every class that would benefit from open for all activities. So this is not just a model for special education teachers or for people with disabilities. This is a model to be used in every class or sports club. All in all, if you have a game where everyone feels welcome and they are able to play it, you have succeeded in game design.
Okay, about the future of gamification. I believe that digital games and apps are becoming more and more popular because devices and therefore games are really good and they are still developing. But as we know, life and trends go in circles. So after this digital circle, it might be as well a massive non-digital wave coming. We definitely also need non-digital solutions and games. Why? No, well, because non-digital games are so easy to comprehend. They are concrete and there's always something you can touch or hold on your hands. So it makes it easier to comprehend. For example, a huge game board or a ball. You can touch it, you can hold it on your hand. It is easier to comprehend what this is all about. Also, non-digital solutions decrease screen time, which is nowadays a real challenge. And non-digital games are also a real natural environment for team playing, face-to-face, or meeting new people. So it's really important. It's an interaction as its most natural way for people, for humankind. And people also need face-to-face interaction for their social well-being. All in all, it's good to have both digital and non-digital games and gamification because they serve partly different goals and needs. Digital platforms will be growing and growing in the future, I believe so. And they are offering us new games, new services that we have never seen or even dreamt. Let's see what will happen next within next 10 years. Thank you for listening to this presentation. Hope you got some new perspectives or hints. Feel free to ask for more on Twitter. Tweet me or send me a direct message to start conversation. I will be answering in English, Finnish or Swedish, so feel free to contact me. Thank you for your time and have a nice seminar in lovely Vaasa. Bye-bye.
Thank you. I hope you hear something. And this limit games, we have four games outside here that you can get a little bit familiar with our limit games. Comments or questions, I try to answer. Presentation will be sort of than in our program, but I think we can manage that.
I have a question, Jukko. How did you start working with using gamification usually used within the digital fashion to use within old-fashioned games and then blowing the size of them up and using them within sports in school? How did the idea come about?
Nico's father of our games. We first tried with video, but it didn't work as well as these board games. And somehow we find not better answer.
It's an innovative way to combine different technologies to get a new solution. Thank you. So let's welcome next speakers up, Andreas Hult, that is from Umeå University. He's going to talk a little bit about innovation competition for a more active campus area. So let's see how you can compete in innovation. That's also a kind of a cross-border initiative going from sports to innovation.
I can tell. Do you hear me? Great. Perfect. Okay. Hello. So my name is Andreas Holt. I'm a researcher in public health at Umeå University. And I'm also a part of the product group Nordink, where I have special interest in research questions. Today I'm going to present one of our cases, which is an innovation contest, and it's called Active Space on Campus. And it's a contest of innovative ideas on health promotion from the Umeå University campus area for teams of students from different programs and specialities. And the concept is developed by Nordink, and the contest was made together with Akademiska Hus, which is a company that owns the buildings on the Umeå University campus. We directed the contest for students of Umeå University, and we tried to recruit groups. Student groups consists of 4 to 6 students from at least 3 different academics programs. Registration was done via the web-based form on the Nordink website, where you could register yourself and then be paired with teammates from other institutions and programs. Alternatively, if you wanted to recruit your own team, you could also do that and register the entire team. So we got a lot of students volunteering from different academic programs, for instance, architecture, dentistry, digital media production, civil engineering, computer science, mechanical engineering, and peace and conflict studies. So as you can see, there were quite a big diversity of different academic programs. And from these students, we made interdisciplinary student teams. And their task was to create an installation of or service that promotes physical activity and recreation around the pond area on the campus of Umeå University. As you can see here on the image, the pond is situated quite in the center of the campus area. And the solution should appeal to many, regardless of age, gender, background, and culture, as well as students and staff. The concept should ideally include both the digital and the physical world. And the innovation should be sustainable, usable in different seasons, and also easy to use. And the criteria that the jury were judging was availability, originality, feasibility, humor, aesthetic quality, and possible health benefits for the individual. And we did this project in order to promote physical activity on campus. And we hope and believe that this competition will contribute to the development of the campus area and results in new innovative solutions that promote both students and staff at Umeå University. And more specifically, we wanted to create natural meeting places by developing the campus area and also get some knowledge transfer in the process in order to promote physical activity in a sustainable way. And we started this during Health Promotion Day that is held twice per year in Umeå University called Hälsa på Campus. So the start was in September 2018, where we started to recruiting students. And then they had about 6 months to conceptualize their ideas. And also you should remember that these are full-time students, so they did this on their spare time, which is quite impressive. We had put together a jury group with representatives from the RISE Interactive Institute, Umeå University, Akademiska Hus, the Umeå Municipality, and Folkhälsan Finland. And also we had a mentors group which could support the student groups, also with representatives from Umeå University, RISE Interactive Institute, Umeå School of Sports Science, Akademiska Hus, Life Medicine at Region Västerbotten, and also Sharing City Umeå. So each of the students group were scheduled 3 meetings with a mentor group. And also, if needed, we could arrange additional meetings. And the total time of the project was 6 months in order to conceptualize their ideas. And in the end, they were competing for a prize sum of 40,000 Swedish crowns, which roughly corresponds to 4,000 euros. And the winning team could choose one of 2 options. The first option was to get travel grants for 25,000 crowns and 15,000 Swedish crowns for the realization of the winning idea. Alternatively, option 2 were realization of the winning idea for the total sum of 40,000 crowns and a plaque at the pond with info of the winner, info and the winner's names. And each student group were asked to make a presentation at the end of the project period, and it was divided into 3 parts. First of all, they had a written part, which was a short description of the identified problem, the working process, and the final solution and its potential impact. Also, they prepared a visual presentation which was a description of the concept and how it was developed. For instance, the sketches, analogous or digital models, an example of utilization of the concept. And finally, they also had the possibility to pitch their idea for the jury group and answer potential questions as well. So soon you will hear a little bit more from the winners of this project. But just to sum it up, this project was developed by members from the Nordic project and run together with an external partner, in this case Akademiska Hus. So we have now developed a working concept for innovations, innovation contests that can be used in collaboration with external partners interested in finding new and innovative ideas. And hopefully, we can make use of all the positive experiences we got in the process and utilize them in upcoming innovation contests with the aim at increasing physical activity in the region. Thank you.
Much of an echo anymore, but maybe there is. All right, hello everyone. We are 2 students from the winning competition of the innovation competition. Our team is called The Light, and I'm Johannes, and this is Fanny.
Hi.
And from Umeå, Oscar, Helen, and Carl says hi. Me, Fanny, and Oscar are architects, and Helen studies the peace and conflict studies, and Carl is a mechanical engineer.
This is so frustrating.
All right. As you know, winters in the northern part of Sweden, as well as here in Finland, get pretty dark. And it's mostly dark for half the year. And and during the winter, the extreme light of the summer is exchanged. It's a very stark contrast between the two seasons. And during the winter then, it's extremely important to light up our surroundings and work with light to make us feel happy and really make the time more bearable. For this competition, we wanted to work with light and physical movement to make a space in Umeå more active and more vibrant throughout the year. And this is our first picture for Umeå campus. As you can see, and as we saw, there's an issue here, especially during the winter. It's very dark, it's kind of sad, and it's a place that a lot of students pass by, yet it's almost never used. And with the light, we want to create a space here that through light and physical movement invites physical activity from passers-by.
And what symbolize both light and the everlasting movement, but the northern lights, a starting point for our project. We wanted to create a place not often so visited at Umeå campus to give new perspectives to the user. The objective of the competition is movement, and we wanted to movement to be fun and playful. Our concept combines the light from a northern light with new perspective of campus and playful movement. We want the light to reproduce the feeling of a dancing northern light, a place people together can engage their bodies and create a moving art piece. The goal is to create a place where people, driven by curiosity, activate their whole body whilst interacting with the pavilion.
Yes, and in simple terms, the pavilion can be described as a walkway with four movement stations over which a northern light is suspended. For us, the northern light is a metal net from which small metal shingles are hung, and these can move with the movements from the movement stations as well as from the wind and so on, which this interaction between the movement station and the movement of the northern light is the core of the project and the main interaction. And I will now explain these four movement stations one by one. And the first movement station is a simple suspension bridge hanging close to the ground. And as you run across, or maybe jump across it, the wires which the suspension bridge is hung is connected to the northern light. And thus your movement is translated to this net and creates waves or ripples in the northern light, reflecting light in new or interesting ways. And the second movement station is a very simple triceps pull. So you pull down on a rope that's attached to the northern light, and in a very direct way creates a new movement, pulling up the Northern Light, and then you can release it. And then the third movement station is a squat opposite of the triceps pull, where you grab a handle from the ground or a place and pull it up with your body. And then the fourth movement station is what we imagined as swing, and it's the most low intense movement. And when designing these movement stations, for us it was important that everyone, no matter how physically active or good with sports, you should be able to interact and have fun with this pavilion. And that's why we introduced different intensities and ease of use for these different movement stations. Yet all have you activate your body in some way, and all in effect the Northern Light, as we see it.
And this is the main part of Umeå University. For those of you who haven't been here, this is the administration building, and up here you have the social sciences and humanity, and down here is the campus pond, and across from that you have the natural science and technology buildings. And also below here, almost outside the picture, you have the university hospital. And we have chosen to place our pavilion at the entrance, if you will, to the Umeå campus, a place that sees many pedestrians and cyclists over the day, but is seldom used. At this location, we catch many students on their way to and from campus. As well as that, the closeness to the bus station and the hospital allows those who are waiting for the bus, or perhaps a patient or two, to use it. This location makes it easy for both students, staff, and bypassers to visit the pavilion. And zooming in on how the pavilion sits in the environment, our aim is to keep most of the existing vegetation, like the trees and also the small stream and the pond. We designed it to move around the existing trees and vegetation, yet reaching out to the existing walkways to create entrance to the pavilion. The walkway is heavily inspired by footbridges, often found in the wildness of Sweden and maybe here in Finland too. Constructed in wood, placed close to the ground to allow for seating. And here you see a small illustration of the intended use. A simple construction as not to make the pavilion hard to construct.
And then we move on to the Northern Light as we imagined it. For us, the construction is a simple metal net, as seen in the first picture. And on that metal net, we intend to fasten like these metal shingles, small metal plates, that reflect light, either artificial light or the sunlight. And then, in the third picture, you can see how we imagine the wind or a physical activity will create waves or ripples in this like metal wave or metal sea hanging above you. And here is a short GIF that illustrates how we want this like roof, this Northern Light, to look like in action. And then here it is reflecting only sunlight, but during the winter half and like the dark period, we imagine to have like artificial light in different colors illuminating the underside of this Northern Light to really simulate and play with the Northern Lights movement in the sky. But up until now, we only really talked about a visual connection with this Northern Light. But we really want to have a deeper connection with more senses, if you will. So that's why we think it's important to add sound to this pavilion. And we intend to do that by fastening small metal bells on these shingles, or some of them. And when the net moves, either by the wind or physical movement, these small bells will hit the metal sheet and create a sound, much like a wind chime does playing in the wind. And here, in a quick section of the pavilion, you can see how we intend to construct the metal Northern Light by having pillars and wires and holding it up in there. The walkways underneath, close to the ground, and maybe going up a little bit and reaching around this space. And on here and underneath the Northern Light are these activity stations placed along around the walkways as to interact with different parts of this Northern Light. And now, coming up on the end of this presentation, is an illustration of how we intend this to look like during the winter in Umeå at the location being illuminated by artificial light. And here is a picture from the site from another direction showing how it could look like during the summer. And here is reflecting the light from the sun and doesn't really require artificial light during the summer half. And you might wonder, how is the process going from now, and what will we do with this right now? And Academica Hus, as mentioned previously, like the housing or facilities companies at Umeå University, have shown interest to getting this built in some shape or form. But before we can really discuss how we do that and like to what extent, there's some like technical issues we have to solve before we can really start constructing it. And most importantly is this metal net, and like, do we have a net that's like light enough to be able to be moved, but still strong enough and big enough to cover this area and really create this feeling of the Northern Light that we want to portray and show. But I think that's all for us, and thank you for listening to us. Thanks.
Thank you. Is there any questions?
Yes.
You can hear me. You said that you, it's really difficult to talk into this microphone. You said that you came from there were war studies and other disciplines taking part in your team. Are you all friends from before, or how did you get this team?
We were friends before, and I think mostly we two and Oscar, perhaps, who studied architecture, were like interested in this competition, and then we were like looking for people that might could be interested to that study from other programs as well.
And like,
do you want to?
Is this one good? No.
Okay.
Nice.
Yeah. And other students, I got to know them like doing student union work. That's how I got to know students from other courses and other programs mainly.
And to the organizers of the competition, what were the rules about making the winning concept realized? Did you have any limits of how much the costs would be and so forth? Did you understand my question?
In the meantime, we can maybe add that like this 40,000 that's part of the prize sum probably isn't enough to realize this. It's like it's maybe enough to prototype and like get the idea and like have some engineer really calculate if it's possible. But like the actual construction and like the groundwork will require more money and like more time to do.
Okay.
Well, I can just add on to that one idea was that we didn't want to have an upper amount, so that would be a limitation in the creative process. But of course, you always have economical boundaries, but we didn't set a fixed limit for this competition.
And for us, like we asked this question to like the jury and like the mentor group. Like, do we have to take this into account? And like, our way to tackle this question was to like make the construction easier. It's like this wooden walkways and like kind of like an easy to construct and easy to do on the site, but then have like a technical part in the Northern Lights, so to say.
Anyone else who has a question? I wanted to ask you from your background as a professional, as an architect, what do you think about combining the architecture in where we are at today with physical activity, and how do you reflect about where the environment, and how do you think when you were doing the project about how can you promote physical activity within the environment?
Well, like personally, I think it's important to make it like feel not forced. Like it should be an option, but it should feel like you're doing it because it's fun or it's a great way to go about your day, and not like have someone say like, yeah, now you should work out because it's good for you. But it's like it should be like a fun part or like inspiration for this project. Was what's it called? It's a Stockholm company that installed a piano in the stairs from a subway station. And during that day, I think it was like 60% more people who chose the stairs instead of the escalator right next to it, just because it was fun to walk up the stairs and you could produce sound as you were doing it. But like it was the exact same stairs, so like the function of the space didn't change. Only the experience of the space as you exercise your way up. And I think that's the important part, like when combining like the built environment and then like exercise, that it should be fun and it should be.
And also driven by curiosity, that you want to see what happens if I do this or this, and can we work together also creating this art piece also is something that is inspiring perhaps for others also seeing something happens on that site as well.
But then I think it's important to think of like how we design spaces. It's like, is it stairs that we take or is it like escalator or elevator that's designed as the intended use? And I think it's like, we have a lot to learn there as well. Like, it's not something that's really touched upon that much during our education. It's like it's more like how you move around the space, but not how you move around the space. So I think there could be more collaboration about what's good for the body and how we can design in that in two spaces.
Okay, thank you very much. So going from looking at physical environment that is really important and very interdisciplinary topic, very well introduced of our fantastic students, it's a difficult topic making the environment sure enough, secure enough to make our cities healthy. And that will be, I think, big topic in the future, how to make the cities healthy when we are expanding. How do we make it movable? We have two opposite forces in society. We want to make everything simple, and then we want to make it that we are healthy. So how do we do it? And how do we feel secure in our environment as well? And I think doing collaborations like this will be very important in the future, opening it up for the knowledge exchange that is important. I will be talking a little bit about measuring physical activity, and that is possible to do in various ways. I will be concentrating talking a bit about activity recognition and the more in a way how to be able to use it. I'm a doctor at profession, and I work with tech guys, and I do research, but I do research because I want new cool things to use for my patients. So I'm one of those impossible people who wants all the new cool things, and I choose to look at my reality that I am not bound by rules because I don't know so much about the technology behind. I just want to use the new cool things. So when we work with technology, I say, oh, I want this. But our tech guys think I'm quite impossible. But that also opens up for good conversations. And my point of view is, how do we look for our region and how do we look at the health perspective for it all? And we have three major challenges facing us, both in Finland and in Sweden and also in Norway. We have demographic changes. We're getting older in our population. We need to have accessibility to services in remote areas. All our areas up here in Korken is regarded as rural areas. We have large differences in terms of access to and also to quality of healthcare services. And how we solve this is up to debate. So the needs for a sustainable society is a shift from focus from treatment to prevention, or from treatment in care centers to treatment and diagnostics within home. Home environments. So if we can change how we do things, instead of taking in all our elderly patients to the hospital, but keeping them at bay at home, both when we're treating them and also when we're diagnosing them, we will get further ahead. We need more technology development when it comes to activity classification and activity recognition to make this possible. We are lacking in this area. Today, we have the basis for it. We have the tech gadgets to collect it. We have wearable products. But how we interpret the data from those wearable products is still up to debate, and that is what we need to develop. Today, we do use data in research. We use the data from activity measurements as classified by accelerometers. For research, we usually use something that's called actigraph. Accelerometers is based on three axles, and we measure what happens. But we don't classify it as more than we take out steps per day, steps per week, light intensity, medium intensity, high intensity. And that's very well and good for research. We can validate that in a very good way. But how do we go from research data, what we know, and we can calculate risk? How do we implement that out in products? Because it's not just about predicting risks. It's about using it to treat, using data from patient themselves, collecting data, analyzing it, and reporting back to them. And then we are talking about fields like behavioral sciences. Within, for example, food industry, they're talking about nudging. Do you know, guys, how many knows what nudging is? A lot of you know. Well, for you who doesn't know, nudging, when you go, for example, for the supermarket, it's when you have the chocolate just by the counter in eyesight, just giving you a nudge before you pay. Don't you need some sugar and chocolate? Put it in your bag and pay. How can we do that with physical activity? How can we promote and nudge to do a little bit more activity? How can we use data, report it in, use it and present it in a way that is applicable, palatable for the individual to move a little bit more? Again, that's using it in a different way is Pokemon Go. They are gamification, they're gamifying it, but they're still just counting the steps. So how do we go from research with steps into products? And then we come into the field of activity recognition. And for me as a physician, well, it's easy. Collect the data and let me know what happens. And the tech guys say, well, it's not that easy. When it comes to collecting data, you want to know that it's reliable. You want to know what source it's been collected on and how and where it's been worn. So depending on where you've been worn, if it's on the wrist, on the pocket, on the hip, you will have a bit different measurements. You also have difference depending on the hardware, on the activity pattern. And then you have different ways of measuring, calculating the activity. But in the end, it's possible to calculate in real time what the individuals are doing, if they're walking, if they're biking, running, walking uphill, sitting, laying down, and so on. So there's a lot of work behind getting this information to package it to doing nudging for people. So we started out doing the basic work, and these algorithms can be made available for developers to be used for different behavioral products. can be used within healthcare, can be used for wellness products. It's a basic algorithm that can be used for other product developments. So we did activity recognition test and performance evaluation. We used a data set of about 30 participants that was collected in one set. We used accelerometers and gyroscopes. And accelerometers and gyroscopes is what is in your smartphones. When we use research instruments from accelerometers, it's just the actigraph, it just contains an accelerometer. But by using your smartphones in different positions located around your body, you can get other measurements and fine-tune these algorithms. And for our case, we used wrist worn for both dominant and non-dominant arm. We used hip trackers. We used pockets in the front and in the back to kind of simulate how the phone is worn today by people. One thing we didn't try to do was put the smartphone in the handbag. But otherwise, we tried to move the phone around to get as good measurement as possible in the end. We did a predefined activity protocol to try to capture the main physical activity patterns that we wanted to classify. We wanted to be able to nudge in walking in stairs, running in different speeds, walking in different inclinations, biking in different speeds, sitting to try to avoid that pattern, and also the same for laying down and for standing still. We collected all these patterns in the lab setting and put them in machine learning environment. And that is somewhere around using a black box, putting in information and seeing what comes out. And actually, I can see that my data is wrong here. We actually had 99.7% accuracy on the algorithms that we could create in the lab to detect patterns in real time. So using these kind of methods actually work pretty good on classic activity patterns in real life. What we're moving forward now with collaboration in Tromsø University, Oulu University, Tyndall Institute of Technology, and Ulster University is looking at other daily activities. For example, vacuuming, carrying a box, washing dishes, for example, to try to classify behavior that is happening on daily living. What other things that you can do with this kind of methodology is using it for nudging for physical activity, for example, in different products. What you also can do is using it for activity classification, for example, within healthcare. A classic example is detection of early dementia signs. Looking at how individuals are moving around within their own apartment, seeing how they are starting to change behavioral. If they are getting worried, if they're changing how they are moving around, changing their behavioral pattern, you can detect that kind of behavior and detect them earlier than just by standard visits at the hospital. It can also be used for mental illnesses, for example, within a home setting. And that usually is the other case around that they become more still they get more inactive, for example. And looking at activity patterns and classify them, you will get a prediction system and an early detection system. And the basic science behind it is the same, but the possibilities for using it in different products and different innovations are very good. So this was what I had to say about activity classifications. Any questions?
Yeah, one question. You're talking about 99.7 in the lab.
Yeah.
Have you started trying in real life settings?
Well, that's always the question. How do you go from lab to real life? We're going to start up a collaboration with Tromsø, and they have about 7,000 1-week measurements, and we have about 4,500 1-week measurements, and we will apply the algorithm on those data sets. But still, the question is, can we actually know what they're doing? So what we will be doing is develop a kind of an intermediate where the app will tell it, will in real time detect what kind of movement you are doing and ask you, are you walking in stairs now? And then you can confirm. It will give you a buzz and ask you, I detect you are going in the stairs, can you confirm? And then the participant can confirm and say yes or no. And that's the way we will try to take the algorithms from lab to use in real life. So that's the next step for us. Or not for me, the tech guys. Thank you.
Joachim, I work at Folkesen and has been a part of Nord Inc. Next up is Peter Ivers, that has been a practical case in Nord Inc. He is developing in shoes, and one of our services is pile testing. And we have been doing that for him. So with 50 persons in OCR that we hope that have helped you to develop an even better shoes. Okay, big hand for Peter.
Okay, thank you, Joachim. I'm going to talk about a little while about envy. There you can see what we make. We make race shoes. We don't make any normal walking shoes or running shoes on the road there's a lot of brands talking about that they make race shoes. But in our opinion, they don't make race shoes. They make shoes for a normal guy or girl want to go for a run, but not for racing. That's the big brands. Like, I don't want to mention the names of those brands, but you all know them. You can find them everywhere. We don't make that. We make only race shoes. Here you can see some of the shoes that we made. The brand is founded last year. It's owned by Nomade Collection in Finland. Nomade Collection also makes clothes, custom made clothes under the brand No Name, and Warren Key from Australia. The guys behind the brand has been in the sport business for around 20 years. We have a very, very strong sport background. You can see that the design team of the shoes, I counted it yesterday, it's a 25 world champ medals altogether. So I really say that I know what they're talking about. The experience that they have is quite unique, because if you put all the four guys behind this in the design team, the experience is something that you can't buy. It's we just have it. This company behind Envy also was the distributor for Innovate for 10 years in Scandinavia. Innovate is a trail running brand and CrossFit brand from England. And I'm going to explain later to you about something that happened concerning Innovate, but we started from zero. Innovate was also a really, really small brand when we started distributed in Scandinavia. And we went to the big chains. We were selling in all these XXL, Stadium, Intersport, Hall of Scandinavia. And once you reach, as a distributor, and once you reach a certain volume, the brand always want to take over. So they kicked us out and took over Scandinavia after that. We sold almost 100,000 pairs of the Innovate, and today I think they're selling 20,000 in Scandinavia. So, okay, they have a better margin, but that's a normal thing. Okay, back to Envy. The reason why we started it was that we saw a demand for super light racing shoes with grip. Normally, when you make trail shoes and OCR shoes and mountain running shoes and orienteering shoes, they don't talk so much about the weight. It's about the grip and the durability. But if you are a racer, you know how important that the weight is. You want to have the lightest shoes possible. Because if you count the steps you take during a race that takes 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, it adds a lot of weight to you. So that's the most important thing. That's our aim, that we have to have the lightest shoes. And the lightest shoes that we have right now, I'll go back to that. That's the red one to the left. That's 169 grams. And we will be able, in about 1 year time, we'll be able to go under 160 to 159. So we need to push all the time, because that's the way we can be different from the other brands. And you see that the goal or the vision that we have is the lightest and I call it grippiest. That's not a real word in English, but with the best grip. And it's only for these sports, orienteering, OCR, mountain running. Mountain running is what you have. That's very popular, especially in Norway, man. They call it motbakkeløp in Norway. When you start down in the valley and finish up on the top of a hill. And trail running. So these are very small niches. It's not any volume where you have 1 million runners in Sweden and 1 million in Norway and 1 million in Finland. We are talking about maybe totally in Scandinavia 200,000 maybe doing these sports, but that's enough for us because we don't want to be the big brand. Here you see, we came to the market in March, and what's that? That's six months ago. This year we sold 10,000 pairs. The forecast for next year is 15,000 pairs. We sell in 16 countries in Europe, Japan, Australia, Canada, and the US. But only to these ports. We will continue to be a small niche brand. And you won't find us if you go to XXL and Stadium, you will never find us. Because once you go into those big chains, your brand is killed because they dump the price. And then you are competing with everybody else, and after 5 years you are gone. So we sell only through really, really specialist shops, small specialist shops where the guys and girls who are selling, they know what they talk about. Normally they are doing the same sports as I was talking about. They are orienteers, OCR runners, mountain runners, trail runners. So they know what they're talking about. And we sell through the web. If you look at our competitors that claim that they have race shoes, they sell, everybody is selling through the big retailers, XXL Stadium and so on. Of course, they have huge volumes, make a lot of money. But we don't, as I said, we don't want to do it. Because if we do it, we get in the same position as them, and then the only thing that counts is the price. So you have to push the price all the time, and then you lose, then you can't be the lightest one, because you have to choose solutions just to push the price. And then you are not the lightest and grippiest shoe anymore. We don't make any ads in any newspaper or traditional medias. I call the sponsors runners, that's the influencers in the sport. Today we work with 40 sponsored runners, and we aim to, in 2 years' time, we aim to have about 100 runners in our team. We started with orienteers because our background is orienteering. Then we went into OCR. Now we are going into mountain running, and next year we are going into trail running. And once again, all these sports, if you are a top athlete, you want to have the lightest shoes. So that's the goal. And we know that right now we have the lightest shoes. Nobody is lighter than 169. Okay, you can find marathon shoes that are lighter, but then you don't have any grip. So a shoe with a good grip, 169 is the lightest one. Of course, social media is also very important. Right now it's Instagram. Who knows what it will be in 5 years' time, but Instagram is definitely the most important channel for us. And once again, no printed medias. It's you have no idea really bring back the money you put into it. So that's something that we definitely are not doing. We see that's no channel for us. The sponsored runners are very important. So that's why we cooperate with the OCR runners. As Joachim said, we are cooperating with the team. And the feedback we get from them is very, very important. It's that's how we can keep the development going all the time, because we need the feedback from the runners, even that we also run ourselves. But okay, we are getting a little bit older, so we need some younger guys to give us the real feedback. I'll tell you once again about the Innovate that we were selling. We started from zero. First 4 or 5 years, tough work. Okay, then you get into those XXL and Stadium, and you start to get some sales, and it's growing. And if you work as a distributor, then the margins are squeezed from the brand who wants to get better prices, to sell more expensive to you, and from the retailer, from the big change, XXL, Stadium, Intersport, that also want to get better prices. So the middleman, the distributor, if he starts with a margin of 30%, then he gets squeezed from the brand by 5%, then 5% from the retailer, then you are left with 20%. What can you do? You have to increase the volume all the time, and in the end you don't have any margin. So the old tradition style or model with a brand, a distributor in every country, and a retailer, that's going to die. All the distributors going to go away inside the European Union, because you don't have the margins. So that's why we don't use distributors at all. We go always direct on the retailers, on the small specialist shops, because that's the only way you can do it in the future. Okay, the volume is smaller, but the retailer get a good margin and we get a good margin. So it's you can see it in it's not only in the sports business, it's in the whole business. Distributors going away, it's only agents selling, mostly on a commission base. One big warehouse in the whole of Europe, and deliver from there directly to the retailer. I can ask Joachim, do you like the shoes?
Yeah, really much. So we had the survey, we had 15 OCR athletes, and you had the answers from them already, so we did the summit. And the response was very good to the shoe, average. But there are also some improvements that can be made. Have you had time to look at the survey and the summary of it, and is the response to that? You know, we haven't presented here, but maybe can tell us a little bit about it.
I haven't looked at on everything of the answers yet, but the response we got during the season is already made the changes for next season, because when you work with shoes, the delivery time is about 6 months. So from you place the order, it's 6 months until it reach Europe. So the shoes that you're gonna use for next year, and everybody else is gonna use, or you can gonna find in the shop, is already ordered in the mid August. So after that, it's impossible to make any changes. But still, we can turn around quite fast. I mean, we can take the feedback we got during the summer, change the shoes, and deliver them next summer. For the big brands, it takes years to make the big changes, because they, you know, it's a big organization, blah, 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 blah. While we are just a few guys who can turn it around fast. So So that's an advantage that we have. But like Joachim said, the feedback that we got, that's very important to be able to make the changes. Okay, that's about what I should tell you.
Christian, did you mention, where are you manufacturing your
options? China. Today, I would love to make them in Finland. I would love to make them here in Vasa. But as you all know, we don't have the infrastructure in Scandinavia, or we don't even have it in Europe anymore to make shoes like this, because they make all kind of walking shoes and so on in Eastern Europe, but the infrastructure is missing, and then, you know, the price would be, it's not even double, it would be triple of today. So that's unfortunately, you have to go to China. I hope it will change. That's what we did with our clothes, with the no-name brand. We were in China, but we took it to Europe 4 years ago. And I'm very glad we did it, because, I mean, it's very good that we can bring back the work to the European Union.
You make shoes for racers. Do you think you have a interest or responsibility? What's your take on getting people in general to move more? Is there a connection between competition and the rest of us?
Normal people. Well, at least you can get inspired. At least you can get inspired from the real elite athletes, the real racers. That's why, well, you know, when you are a small kid, what are you looking on? You are looking on the big sports stars and want to become as the big sports stars. That's why you start to play hockey or football or skiing or whatever you do. So, well, somehow, yes, if you can supply the real racers with good shoes, maybe we can inspire somebody to start to move. Maybe they don't use other shoes, but at least they start to move.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So this was our last speaker before lunch. I wanted to end up with a little exercise before lunch, or while we're hitting our lunch. Trying to get to know each other. We are having lunch until 12:45, then we'll meet back to here. And we are hoping for some networking and finding new collaborations for you all during the lunch. So I'm going to ask you some questions, and then maybe you can raise a hand if you feel like you are in that category. How many has interest in virtual reality? Raise your hand. Then you know who to go and talk to during the lunch. Who's into healthcare? Who is in the company zone? Who's into sports? Right. And who's into high performance? Great. then you know a little bit on who you can go and talk to a bit more during the break. We have some areas during the lunch you can go and have a look at as well. Go mingle, enjoy the nice lunch, and we'll meet back here again at 12:45. Thank you.
Men jag kan vara så här.
Jag måste ha en där som något. Så här, är det här bra? Det hörs ju ganska bra.
Hörs det?
Hörs.
Hörs det när jag säger?
Hörs det? Hörs det? Hörs det någon när jag talar så här eller? Ja, så här. Är det här bra nu då? Nej, jag tycker den känns
men det är
det. Jag vet inte.
Men det är med den här som måste ju stå över tillräckligt nära.
Ja, ja, jag måste liksom.
Ja, du kan inte.
Och sen har jag det fel att jag börjar gå så här. Men det här är rundgång också. Här är rundgång också, va? Eller? Får man den här liksom lite.
Men du behöver inte vara så nära.
Och ekade inte den där.
Men jag har ju det problemet att jag tycker inte att man står stilla.
Nej, det är inte. Därför så blir det just det där. Mitt jag så far du hit.
Ja, så märker jag.
Då måste man ta sån här.
Mick Jagger style.
Jag är inte med den där. Gick det inte ganska bra med
den? Eka den här också. Nej, den här funkar nog här bra för mig.
Nej,
inte
han har gjort här nu senast. Givars. Hade han inte den där?
Ja, det är väl kanske.
Jag får allas.
Ja, verkligen. Ja, det är lite som eftersläp.
Är det inte här liksom?
Hallå.
Professionell.
Hallå. Hallå.
Är den på nu mer?
Hallå. Är det rundgång?
Ja.
Det är lite rundgång.
Men jag tror att det blir mer.
Eller den är sen.
Den är sen. Alltså,
det blir en rundgång, men man hör din vanliga röst först och så kommer den där lite för sen.
Nej, vi vill inte höra dig så. Vi vill höra dig den där. Tack så mycket. Du får ta den där. Shit. Ja, det kan bra. Du får hålla i bordet som har stått på plats.
Nej, du får komma hit och hålla i.
Du kan
göra
så här.
Du får komma hit och hålla på.
Nej. Nej, 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 men testa nu att den där YouTube-grejen brukar höras.
Nej.
Hur
ser
det
ut? Nej,
det
ser också här. Det är
inte så bra. Nej, det är PDF så blir den lite sådär.
Det är ingen bra. Vadå? Det ser ut så här. Men kan du?
Vi kan inte liksom, man kan knycka.
Men alltså den här andra.
Mm.
Vi måste ju se om den.
Men jag har ju
det är så här det ser ut då.
Ja, den funkar inte.
Mm. Du måste scrolla den.
Sen.
Men det är men kan
det vara ljudet säkert.
Kan ni ta min dator?
Jag provkör den så vi hör ljudet.
Men syns det vid din? Jag är inte säker. Men nu ringer
jag oss.
Nu har du räckt.
Har du det?
Ja.
Den är fin. Tats, varför är det så lite djup? Det är samma sak med den där mikrosöpen. Har vi fullt på
den? Det är roligt. Men det tar bra på marken.
Får man inte mer göra det?
Och sen måste jag stoppa.
Vad är det man gör?
Så kommer det fullt ut.
Ja, då är det mycket. La la la. Den ska inte skjuta ner, den ska stänga.
Varför funkar inte det där PowerPoint?
Men titta på det nu. Det är det som är liksom helt... Där, här är alla fonter åt helsike.
Också om du sätter det på den där presentationen.
Jo, ja. Du får nog hålla det så här om du vill, men sen blir det så här.
Men alltid... Nu var det bättre det här, inte det som fan.
Nå visst, det ser ju jätteoproffsigt ut. Jag går inte med. Tycker du att det här är snyggt?
Vad har hänt med den då?
Vad ser du det? Den där folkhälsans egen... Den där...
Bakgrundsmodellen.
Ja, som inte klarar av i andra
system.
Ja.
Alltså det är så, måste jag sitta och leka med den här? Så går det inte. No, men ska jag sitta här nu och fixa de här?
Nej.
Med några egna? Det går ganska snabbt. Men då äter jag ingenting.
Men hör du om vi scrollar det då? Är det så farligt?
Jo.
Jag kan inte ändra allt på en gång utan du måste gå.
Jag tror att jag måste göra.
Hallå, kan du göra så att ni är här? Hallå. Okej, jag hör dig. Vi försöker få upp Nippes och Niklas presentation, men jag ska presentera här efteråt.
Jag tror jag stänger av.
Stäng där, vi behöver inte. Jag står här och gör det.
Går det att göra något åt det? Ja, jag vet, men jag finns något jag kan göra åt det. Nej. De har inte datorn med. Det var jag har med, men det där från min dator har ingenting installerat. Får de installera det själv? Kan någon hjälpa mig? Yes, tack. Hej. Ja, hej.
Vem då?
Fixar det min?
Men jag håller på här och ändra ifall det inte går.
Skickar du den senaste? Men...
Det kan jag inte göra härifrån. Alltså, när har jag skickat det?
Hej, förlåt, jag ska ringa till dig. Sorry, hej. Va? Ah, ja, jag försöker ringa till Ramstein så att jag ska få den fixat. Säkert. Hittar du den? I garderoben. Jag gissar det. Men jag skickar bilen åt dig.
Stör inte mig. Vem var det, din man?
Nej.
Men han har fått den senaste.
Va?
Han har fått den senaste.
Ja.
Skicka inte åt den. Det kanske inte. Det var nog dumt.
Vad sa du?
Det var nog dumt av mig.
Jag kan alltså få det fixat.
Jag är inte helt säker.
Visar från min dator.
Ja, jag vet. Men det har, jag har stött på problem när det gäller det här.
Oj. Hallå.
Sorry att här är ekvalyptusträ. Får jag den här månen lite mer blörd? Känns ju lite.
Hej, kan du skicka den senaste versionen av presentationen? Jag tror inte att jag har den. Mitt behöver skicka den senaste av dig sen. Där bredvid VR. Ja. Tack, hej. Det är jättedumt.
Det också. Det där är okej. Lite avslutas snyggt.
Men det här är ett problem. Mippe och Niklas ska presentera en grej här i Vasa om en liten stund. Och deras presentation ser tokig ut när de visar den från den här konferensens dator för att de har inte fonterna. Och jag har inte dem heller så jag ska behöva få dem installerade på min dator.
Det går lite
ojämnt i
trapporna. Man kan inte köra
trappor. Nej,
just det. Där. Nu. Just här.
Får jag visa hur är den på där?
Pekka.
Titta nu.
Silla heter den ena, var heter den andra?
Sådär.
Får du dig i mål?
Ja, så.
Nu har du plockat dig. Jag tar bort den.
Se, Silla.
Nej, du ska ta den. Ja, ja, du får gärna plocka dig.
Nu räcker det.
Nu räcker det. Hurra! Det var liksom dagens gymnastik.
Wow!
Yes!
Du
är helt svettig.
Tack. Det är ju en rolig lek. Nu vet jag bra på marken.
Kommer du ihåg våra fonta
heter? Våra fonta är Schiller. Schiller.
Schiller?
Jag tror det är Schiller.
Silla heter den ena. Det är den där.
Nej, jag tycker att det är shish. Naja, okej.
Okay. Silla är så här mitten. Ja, kan du stava det?
Va?
Kan du stava det?
CH.
CH.
Jag kan titta här. Jag tror att den... Det
var kallt. Jag försöker hitta min telefon. Hitta den.
Det går så där. Ah, men då tar vi bort den där. Förlåt, jag här måste ändra den punktet här. Det var inte kompatibel. Fonterna syntes inte.
Ja, typiskt.
Ja. Det är allt, ja. Den heter...
Jag har kopplat inte telefonen för att tänka något lokalt strul. Vänta lite.
Silla FH-skript. Silla FH-skript.
Silla FH-skript. Och då är det alltså C-I-L-L-A. Silla är det ena och det andra är vadå?
Här. Det är den där.
Ja.
Något annat vet jag inte.
Det
brukar vara det där som är där robotar.
Robot.
Men jag är inte säker om det är så. Att om det är fel på mig.
Jag tror att robotar är det andra.
Men annars får vi ta det på det här sättet.
Men det kan hända att mitt benån är öst. Men om du skulle få det här att funka så skulle vi veta. Ja, jag försöker använda den här telefonen.
Jag har fullt nät på min telefon, så är det att den försöker kontakta
mig med den här. Den
har väl tillbaka till under problemet.
Mm.
Jag står här samma dag, jag
ser. Så gör vi alla. Vad är wifi? Läser du det här?
Ingen aning. Den här öppna är liksom... Okej, då måste vi komma ihåg.
Jo, nej, jag är inte där. Jag är ju bara så.
Så där nästa. Så där. Om inte du kommer på något annat så använder vi den här. Den är fulare än vanligt, men...
Okej, det får vara. Vi lever med det här. Tack Tommy för att försöka med det.
Vi får ta det sen.
Vi ska fixa det så att det inte är så här nästa gång. Tack, moi! Ingenting funkar nu så att det var helt rätt på det
sättet. Det är bra. Så. Så jag stänger
det
här, va?
Det ser jättebra ut och det är jättekänt att du får den där videon och spela därifrån.
Så vill du ha den på där uppe eller? Ja, du kan ta bort den så syns inte det som så. Jag gjorde faktiskt riktigt just min presentation också.
Det här har jag gjort för länge sedan, men den bara inte...
Funkar den här? Nej, den här funkar bara med... Funkar det... Vet du om den här funkar?
Den borde funka, ja.
Ja, men det är bra.
Du går äta.
Ja.
Thank you. Thank you. Du körde din egen dator.
Ja.
Ja.
Hur är det?
Jag har lagt över på ett USB-minne också. Jag funderar på liksom, annars, var ser jag mina bilder? Om jag inte kör på min egen dator, ser jag dem då på den där? Eller måste jag stå så här?
Ja, men du ser dem på den datorn du
kör. Så om jag stoppar in USB-minnet?
Ja.
Någonstans?
Ja, det är burken som står där under.
Där.
Den där. Ja,
då ser jag det där.
Ja.
Men jag kan inte få så här presentationsvy, va?
Nej, det var ju därför jag körde min egen. För att det går inte från presentationsvy.
Ja. Och då är det den här kabeln?
Ja, precis.
Och den har Mac. Då kollar vi om det funkar.
Ja, det var smidigt.
Jag har inte skrivit ut någonting heller, så jag kan stå så här förberedd som du och stå så här och byta där, det var så skönt.
Jag brukar tänka, fake it until you make it.
No. We all live by that.
here's the problem. Testing is an exoskeleton type of yeah, you attach it to your thighs and
with the cords for extra resistance or
no, it's it has nothing to do with that in itself, but they can be combined, I think. I'll see about that.
Let's see where we can have your presentation. Hey Sabina,
do you know? No, I know nothing.
I was hoping you would say.
At least I heard my video. Like.
Yeah, I know they were.
Just.
I think they uploaded it onto to this.
Oh, they're all there, are they?
So, they might be all here.
Not on the same. Multiple windows. Thomas just mentioned that was there supposed to be a PowerPoint, and I was like, yeah, for sure, was supposed to be one.
Did you send one, or?
Yeah, I did. I did send a PowerPoint slideshow and one video to accompany it. I do have another copy with me, so.
You do.
Okay.
Bring it on.
But it should
see.
Be here. Like the problem is, the problem often with PowerPoint is that when there are different. Versions, this
yeah.
May just
exactly.
Down,
so. I have videos in this one, so I think I'm going to use my own computer instead.
Yeah, I wish I could, but it just broke down last
yeah.
week, so I got no option.
But otherwise, we could, if you have it on a USB stick, I can
put it in
again.
Yeah. Well, maybe we could ask Thomas first.
Yeah.
I'll go and get Thomas.
If that's not too much of a
of course not.
Inconvenience.
Technology. We work with technology. We have a digital project, but I hate technology.
Yeah, it's very, very nice when it functions the right way, but it just isn't often the case.
I don't like to stand right in front of the slideshow. I usually want to stand.
Yeah.
At the edge of it, so I can point and I can use like the whole picture.
Yeah, I'm very much used to the same thing, and this is I like to walk from one side to the other when I talk. That's just I've learned to do it in the army,
yeah.
But no, it won't happen here. But it's all the same. Like I still enjoy bringing these things out for people to see. Especially when I'm at 100%, I'm still recovering
yeah.
from flu a bit. So,
oh.
So.
Eikö meinaa toi?
Siis tuliko niin kuin kaikki vain perille, se on nyt se kysymys. Et video mä tosiaan kuulin, se lähti tuossa pyörän jossain vaiheessa, sielläpä se onkin. Mutta tuliko mun PowerPoint? Mä voin hakea tuolta. Samassa sähköpostiviestissä, missä tuo on ollut liitteenä, niin.
Ei, mutta meillä oli auki tuo tikun tuo, mihin se on mennyt. Tää ei ole tää.
Ei ole mun. No jos avaat on tiedostosijainen, missä se video on, niin löytyisikö se PowerPoint samasta mestasta?
Joo, kato, meillä oli ladattuna se, mutta tää esi. Tämä aukeama nyt on muuttunut, että mä en tiedä, joku on täällä.
Joo, mä vilkasin läpi, mitä siinä on muuten sulkenut mitään. Ville Piispanen. Onko se pysynyt ehjänä?
Ota tuo nuolet vaikka tai tuosta mukavaa.
Yeah.
Oh.
It's some problems with the video quality, but it should be adequate in the end when it's rendered a bit.
Paina play. Oletko käyttää tää mikki vai sitten tää
vielä mikä repoa on yksi mahdollista.
Tämä, joo. Toinen vaihtoehto on käyttää nyt tämä systeemi, mutta se sitoo sua tähän.
Joo, ne on kaikkien tutuja. Mä en välttämättä varmaan ole startuja, jos se on helposti kuskattavasti, mitä nyt käytän kyllä. Joo, noilla pärjää. Hyvä, hyvä.
Men han sa det att man lägger sig bättre att stå där.
Did you get your videos and everything working?
Finslipar du ens?
Nej, finslip. Jag bestämmer vad jag ska säga till vilken bild.
Niin se on vähän tämä
nykyään
suora nurkka.
Vitsi soikko.
Suora nurkka.
Niin, ne vaihtaa ne
pyöreän nurkat ja suora.
Okei. Kiitos. I learned a new
finish
word yesterday.
Okay,
about
what is that?
Marikka. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Marikka. That's right.
Tärkeä sana.
It's important.
It's important, yeah.
Yeah.
Haluatko sä käyttää tätä vai tämäkin toimii?
Katsotaan joo tässä miten.
Riippuu vähän kun meinaat liikkua.
Niin.
Mutta se kyllä se varmaan toimii noinkin.